So recording is okay.
Hi everyone, nice to be here finally in the Janssen's Eco webinar. My name is Veronica, as already Desi said. Thanks for the introduction, Desi. And today I will present the part of my PhD thesis, which I finished last week, and with the title Estimating Crop Ecophysiology, Synergies Between Thermal, Optical and Crop Pie Information. During this presentation, I will a little bit talk about myself, but I will talk mainly about my PhD motivation and background, the main objectives, and then I will focus in one of the papers talking about the specific objectives, the methods, results, and conclusions. And I will also talk a little bit about aerial tools, where I'm co-founder, but just a little bit about myself. I did my bachelor in aerospace engineering in the Polytechnical University of Madrid. Then I went to England for a couple of years to learn English. And then I came to Denmark to study a master in environmental engineering in the Technical University of Denmark. And after that, I met my main supervisor, Monica Garcia, and she told me a lot of things about remote sensing, and I fell in love with that. And then I conducted my PhD in remote sensing. And from that, working with drones and trying to understand better how plants respond to different stressors, we realized that the drones are not what are supposed to be. So with my partner, we started aerial tools, which I will talk a little bit about later. So nowadays, everyone is aware of climate change, and due to climate change, we are experiencing increases in frequency, intensity, and duration of extreme weather conditions. When we talk about extreme weather conditions, I will focus mainly on soil droughts and during these presentations, but we can also talk about heat waves. Droughts and heat waves often come together. So when an increase in air temperature, we can have an increase in evaporative fraction, which will contribute, an increase in high water demand, which will contribute in the soil, in soil drought. And with drier soils, in turn, warms the atmosphere, preventing water loss for evapotranspiration. But also with an increase in air temperature, an increase in air temperature is indirectly affecting precipitation deficits, which also contributes to soil drought. It's important to mention that irrigation in agriculture accounts already 70% of the global freshwater withdrawals, which is a lot, and with a higher water demand cannot be sustained. And in addition, crops are feeling stress under droughts and heat waves, which is reflected in crops yield reductions. Here we have some global maps from maize crops and soybean, where we can see a significant decreases in average yield in warmer areas in the center of these maps and colored by blue. So crops' responses to stress can occur due to a reduction of soil water content or an increase in air temperature. But it's important to mention that under stress, plants react with several physiological, biochemical, and morphological adjustments, which help crops to acclimate to the environment. These adjustments can happen in seconds, but can also happen in several weeks. So for example, if we look at the leaf and we zoom it, we see that the leaf is composed by stomatas, which are small pores in the leaves that allow the exchange of CO2 and water between the environment and the leaf. And why it's important stomata is because it responds quite fast to stress. So stomatal conductance is an important variable to assess stress. However, plants have complex mechanisms varying stress sensitivity depending on the species, varieties, the structure of the canopy, the age of the plant, environmental factors, and duration of the stress. Now, if we take a look, a closer look to the stomatal conductance compared to the air temperature, we can see that the response is quite complex and is not linear. And in addition, we can see that there are trade-offs between carbon gain and or photosynthesis and evaporative cooling or transpirations. Remote sensing is a non-destructive approach that provides the possibility to early detect changes due to soil drought and heat waves more efficiently over space and time than in situ measurements, as you probably already know. But if we look in the optical range, vegetation presents a unique spectral signature, and reflectance modifications can be associated to changes in leaf pigments if we look at the visible range, or cell structure if we look at the near infrared range, or leaf biochemicals and water content if we look at the short wave infrared. This information can be captured from vegetation indices, which are combinations of reflectance at two or three specific bands, highlighting a particular property of vegetation. For example, as everyone knows, the well-known NDVI, or normalized different vegetation indices, uses the 800 and 670 nanometers, and with that we can estimate the leaf area index or chlorophyll content changes due to stress. However, vegetation indices do not take advantage of the full spectra by using two or three specific bands. It is still not clear the link between function and reflectance under stress, and it is difficult to separate stress responses from phenology. So to go a little bit further, we can use models that using remote sensing that can help to simulate and predict vegetation responses towards a changing environment. In addition, models can take advantage of synergies between spectral domains to better understand crop responses to stress. We can classify models between data-driven or physically-based models. Today, I will focus on a specific data-driven, but the data-driven model is based on statistical relationships between responses and response and predictor, and we don't need to have previous knowledge of physical behavior to use this type of models. Physically based models are based on equations describing the main physical processes of water and carbon cycles. However, most of the models using remote sensing do not differentiate between photosynthetic pathways or hydraulic strategies. For example, soybean is a C3 plant, while maize have evolved to stand warmer temperatures and is a C4 plant. Now, if we look at the hydraulic strategies, we can differentiate between isohydric or anisohydric. Isohydric plants keep a water potential gradient more constant, and they under water stress, they tend to close stomata faster than anisohydric plants that keep variable water potential gradient. Complex ecophysiological interactions with implication on plant mechanisms can be addressed by the leaf temperature, and we can do that from the thermal remote sensing. Leaf temperature is a very important component in the leaf energy balance. In addition, leaf temperature can be associated to photosynthesis and stomatal conductance. In the leaf energy balance, the leaf energy balance includes the net radiation, which is the total available energy for the leaf, which is obtained from short wave and long wave incoming radiation minus the short wave and long wave outgoing radiation. But the net radiation can be dissipated at sensible heat flux or latent heat flux or evapotranspiration. And the energy balance also includes the metabolic energy flux. But this term is usually very small compared to the other ones and usually neglected. The last term is the heat storage in transient condition, but under steady state conditions, this term is zero. Why I'm talking about the leaf energy balance is because these five components are very important, are dependent on leaf temperature, but especially the long wave outgoing radiation is a function of leaf temperature. I want to introduce a little bit about chlorophyll fluorescence, but I'm not going to focus today in this, maybe in the next meeting. but between 650 and 800 nanometers, about 2% of the light absorbed by the chlorophyll molecule is emitted as chlorophyll fluorescence, where we can find a maximum in 685 nanometers and 740 nanometers, including photosystem 2 and photosystem 1. In remote sensing, it's commonly used sun-induced chlorophyll fluorescence to estimate, because it's inversely correlated to gross primary productivity. This parameter is usually obtained from passive remote sensing. However, major understanding of the fluorescence processes are made at the leaf level, and this can be obtained by active measurements with fluorometers. If we take a closer look to the leaf, we can see that the absorbed photosynthetically active radiation can be used for photosynthesis, but a small part can be remitted as fluorescence, and a big part can be dissipated as heat. It's important to consider this because this can be included in the leaf energy balance. So the main objective of my PhD thesis was to provide methodologies and improve our understanding of crop responses to water stress and extreme air temperatures using thermal and optical remote sensing at leaf and canopy levels. For that, I conducted two growth chambers experiments, one in Denmark and then a second one in China. And in addition, I used several flight campaigns in the Danish Dicobarans willow plantation, which is located here in Denmark during the spring summer 2016 and 2017. Today, I will mainly talk about the first paper, which is this one. And here the main objective was to assess how soybean and maize, which present different hydraulic strategies and photosynthetic pathways, cope with water stress under control conditions using thermal and hyperspectral remote sensing. But in this study, we also use canopy high because it can be obtained from LiDAR sensors in the future. In addition, in this study, we use a machine learning model, a partial least square regression model, to evaluate the benefits of this data-driven model to predict ecophysiology compared to common vegetation indices. So the experiment was conducted in Denmark during April 2018 and May 2018, where we set constant air temperature and constant relative humidity during the day. During this experiment, we grew soybean and maize plants. We had six replicates of each and in pots of 9 liters. And to assess changes to water stress, we had three different water or soil moisture scenarios, where we had the wet one, which with 100% water holding capacity. This was plants that we consider that they were under well water conditions. Then we have the middle one with 70% and a dry one with 40% water holding capacity, which we consider that they were under water stress. During this experiment, we also obtain evapotranspiration by a water balance approach by weighting the pots before and after irrigation. And in addition, we conducted leaf gas exchange measurements every 2 to 3 days. And here in this table, you can see the dates where we conducted measurements in the plants. As a result, we observed that the evapotranspiration in soybean decreased about 35%, which was significantly different between the wet and the dry soil scenarios, while maize plants show an evapotranspiration decrease of about 23% from wet to the dry soil scenario. Now, if we look at the leaf gas exchange parameters, such as transpiration, photosynthesis, and stomatal conductance, for soybean, we also observe that under water stress, reducing 60% of the soil water content, these ecophysiological parameters were reduced. However, in maize, we didn't find any significant differences. Therefore, we can say that under 60% soil water content reduction, soybean closes stomatas, reducing photosynthesis and transpiration, and in this way we could classify soybean as an isoidric plant. However, we didn't see any significant differences in stomatal conductance in maize, so they seem to be to keep open stomata independently of the soil water content, which allow us to classify maize as an isoidric plant within our experiment conditions. In this experiment, we also used remote sensing measurements, and we had a thermal camera and a hyperspectral camera. The hyperspectral camera has 125 bands in the visible and the near infrared ranges, and this cameras were located in this small wooden box, which is usually placed in an unmanned aerial system or drone. But in our experiment, we placed it under the ceiling at about 2 meters high over the pots. And for example, here you can see some images of the cameras in the growth chamber. Of course, before using a remote sensing images, we calibrated the cameras, but we also removed the background pixels of reflectance and radiometric temperature to only focus on the vegetation cover and of radiometric temperature and reflectance. So using only the vegetation cover, we calculated 13 vegetation indices by selecting 2 or 3 specific spectral bands. And the selection of vegetation indices was based on literature review, where they observed changes in structural properties, pigments, and photochemical activity under water stress. In addition, we used the leaf air temperature difference because it has been already shown to be sensitive to changes in water stress. From our results, we observed that the leaf air radiometric temperature for soybean was significantly different, so it was significantly higher for the dry soil scenario than the wet soil scenario, while in maize we didn't see any differences in the 3 water treatments. Also, in the last day of the experiment, we measured leaf area index, and from those results we can see that in soybean we don't have significant differences between especially the dry and the wet soil scenarios, while in maize, we observe that the plants under 60% soil water content reductions, they were reducing their leaf area index also. So from that, we can say that the soybean and maize present different coping strategies under our under the specific conditions we had in our experiment. And we saw that the soybean undertake physiological adjustments by closing stomatas with the reduction of soil water content and increasing leaf temperature, while maize adjust their morphology by reducing leaf area index and also canopy height with the 60% reduction in soil water content. Also, if we look at a little bit about vegetation indices, here we can see the leaf air temperature difference and the DVI compared to photosynthesis, stomatal conductance and transpiration at the leaf level, but also compared to the canopy height. For soybean with the blue crosses and for maize with the red dots. And we are for leaf air temperature difference, we only observe significant differences with the significant changes with the stomatal conductance and transpiration, but only for soybean. While for NDVI, we only observe significant differences in maize plants. And in comparing NDVI with canopy high, we observed that an increase in canopy high was also increasing NDVI, which is a significant relationship. So although vegetation indices provide an overview to understand the link between physiological and reflective changes, in our case, almost none of the vegetation indices responded just to water stress. So to go a step further, we conducted a partial least square regression model to predict stomatal conductance, transpiration, and photosynthesis by using reflectance from the hyperspectral camera, leaf radiometric temperature from the thermal camera, and canopy height. The model was conducted several times. In the first time, we used only hyperspectral camera, then we included thermal, and then we added canopy high to observe what were the model performance. It's important to mention that the data was normalized beforehand to remove undesirable obstructive systematic variation. In addition, the data to evaluate was split between 70% calibration and 30% calibration to evaluate the uncertainty of the model. And this splitting of the data was conducted over 500 iterations with the bootstrapping approach. We use statistic measurements for to evaluate the model performance, and also in order to avoid overfitting and find the optimal number of components, we apply a tenfold cross-validation, where we estimated the best number of components by minimizing the corresponding mean square error over 15 latent variables or components. And here we can see that for the tenfold cross-validations, we only use the calibration dataset, and we split it in tenfolds. In addition, we calculated the variable importance of projections to assess the contribution of each band or variable in across components. From our results, we can see that we found that ecophysiological parameters can be better predicted using machine learning than vegetation indices. And here we can see the stomatal conductance measure compared to the predicted stomatal conductance, where we observe that for calibration and validation, we had a good correlation, but also we have small errors. Looking at the variable importance of projection for soybean in blue and for maize in red colors, we observe that for stomatal conductance and all the other two variables, the most important parameters to estimate ecophysiology in soybean was leaf radiometric temperature, while in maize was a canopy high. In addition, we observed that including leaf radiometric temperature to hyperspectral data was improving model performance to estimate ecophysiological parameters for soybean, while the model was improved when adding a canopy high. In addition, from these results, we observed the most important wavelengths for the in hyperspectral from the hyperspectral data, and we found that they were not centered at the same bands that the vegetation indices, which highlights the importance of using hyperspectral data. Therefore, from these results, we can say that synergies of hyperspectral thermal and canopy high information can help to better understand ecophysiological responses to water stress. In addition, this underlies the differences between a crop such as soybean and maize. As a conclusion, we found that soybean and maize have different coping strategies to water stress, which emphasize on the importance to assess crops independently. We also found that the vegetation indices provide an overview to understand the link between physiological and reflectance changes. However, hyperspectral information can provide better understanding of crop responses to stress by discovering unknown information from combination of more than two or three specific bands. And from PLSR results, we found the importance of synergies between hyperspectral, thermal, and canopy high information. Also, I want to talk a little bit about aerial tools. In aerial tools, we are developing not only a drone, but a smart aerial platform that can fly about 4 hours and 3 kilograms of payloads. This idea came by using drones at DTU. And our drone uses a vertical takeoff and landing technology. And it is easy to assembly. But we also can say that this is a smart system because from the findings from my PhD, I believe that it's important to have synergies between different sensors an optical domain. So in our drone, we can place more than one sensor with a plug and play system. And in addition, will allow it, it has an easy collection that will allow in the future to connect a 5G network or implement artificial intelligence solutions. And also, I would like to add that in aerial tools, we believe that the new era of drones is here. And now with the new regulation of drones, we can fly beyond visual line of sight. So thank you so much for listening. And thank you all for joining the Jan Senseco webinar. If you have any questions, here is my personal email and my LinkedIn account. And if you want to know more about aerial tools, you can also contact to this information. Thank you, and that's all.